You've been doing something every single night of your life, and you've been doing it wrong. Not completely wrong, but wrong enough that it's costing you. Costing you memory. Costing you mental sharpness. Maybe even costing you actual brain volume. Sleep. The thing you think you understand because, well, you've been doing it since the day you were born. Here's what nobody told you. While you're unconscious, your brain is running the most sophisticated optimization program in nature. It's consolidating memories, rebuilding neural pathways, literally growing and shrinking different regions based on choices you didn't even know you were making. And that number you've been chasing, those 8 hours everyone talks about, the science says you've been chasing the wrong number. Over the next few minutes, I'm going to walk you through every hidden advantage your sleeping hours give you. Not the stuff you've heard before, the stuff that changes how you think about rest forever. Let's start with the number that's been lying to you. Chapter 1. The number you've been told is wrong. The 8-hour rule. You've heard it from your parents, your doctors, every health article you've ever skimmed. 8 hours, the golden standard. The number that supposedly separates the well-rested from the walking zombies. But here's the thing. When researchers actually tested this, and I'm talking about one of the largest sleep studies ever conducted, tracking over 500,000 people through the UK Biobank, they found something that contradicts almost everything you've been told. The cognitive sweet spot isn't 8 hours. It's 7. 7 hours of sleep produced the highest scores across every cognitive measure they tested. Memory performance, reasoning ability, processing speed, executive function. All of them peaked at 7 hours, not 8. Now, this isn't me saying sleep less and feel superior about it. There's a range here. The research shows stable cognitive performance anywhere from about 5.5 to 7.5 hours. But the peak, the absolute optimal point for brain performance, sits right at 7. So why have we been told 8 hours for so long? Partly tradition, partly because 8 is a nice round number that divides the day into neat thirds. But the data tells a different story. And it gets more interesting. Because the relationship between sleep and cognitive function isn't a straight line where more is always better. It's something far more surprising. Chapter 2. The danger zone on both sides. Here's where most people's understanding of sleep completely falls apart. We all know that too little sleep is bad. Pull an all-nighter and you feel it the next day. Chronic sleep deprivation and you're practically running on fumes. No surprise there. But what the research reveals is genuinely unsettling. Too much sleep is just as damaging as too little. It's called a U-shaped curve. On one side, you have sleep deprivation. Below 4.5 hours, your cognitive function craters. Attention suffers. Memory fails. Your brain essentially starts misfiring. On the other side, above 8 to 9 hours regularly, something similar happens. Your cognition declines. And here's the part that really got my attention. The brain scans show it. When researchers measured gray matter volume across 46 different brain regions, they found the same pattern. Too little sleep, brain regions shrink. Too much sleep, those same regions shrink. Your brain physically changes based on how much you sleep. Not metaphorically, literally. The volume of brain tissue responds to your sleep duration. And the optimal point for maximizing that volume sits right in that 6 to 8 hour window. This means sleeping 9 hours isn't giving you bonus recovery. It might actually be costing you the same cognitive ground as sleeping 5. But this raises an obvious question. What's actually happening during those hours that makes the amount matter so much? Chapter 3. What your brain is actually doing while you're out. Most people think of sleep as the brain's off switch. You close your eyes, consciousness fades, and your brain takes a break until morning. That's not even close to what's happening. During sleep, your brain isn't resting. It's working. In some ways, it's working harder than when you're awake. Sleep comes in stages, and each stage has a specific job. You've probably heard of REM sleep. That's when you dream. But there's also non-REM sleep, which includes something called slow wave sleep, or deep sleep. These aren't just different levels of unconsciousness. They're different modes of brain operation, each handling different tasks. During REM sleep, your brain is actually more metabolically active than during some waking states. Neurons are firing. Neurotransmitters are flooding through circuits. It's intense work happening behind closed eyelids. During slow wave sleep, your brain shifts into a different gear. The electrical activity changes completely. Long, slow oscillations ripple through your cortex. This is when some of the most critical maintenance work happens. Think of sleep less like shutting down a computer and more like running essential system updates. The machine looks inactive from the outside, but inside, crucial processes are running that can't happen while you're using it. So what exactly is your brain working on during all this hidden activity? Chapter 4, the memory consolidation factory. Let's talk about what's really happening to your memories while you sleep. Every day, you take in enormous amounts of information, conversations, things you read, experiences you have, skills you practice. Your hippocampus, a small curved structure deep in your brain, acts like a temporary holding area for all of this. Think of it as the world's most overworked intern, frantically taking notes all day long. But here's the problem. The hippocampus can't hold everything forever. It wasn't designed to. It's meant to capture information quickly, then transfer the important stuff somewhere more permanent. That transfer happens during sleep. While you're unconscious, your hippocampus starts replaying the day's experiences, not at normal speed, at something like 10 to 20 times faster. It's running compressed highlight reels of everything you experienced, and it's doing this over and over throughout the night. This process is called neural replay, and it's how memories get moved from temporary storage in the hippocampus to permanent storage in your cortex. During slow wave sleep specifically, this replay triggers a cascade of activity. The hippocampus fires, the cortex responds, and connections get strengthened along pathways that represent the memories worth keeping. By morning, what was just a fleeting experience the day before has become something more stable, more permanent, actually yours. But there's a catch. Your brain can't just keep adding memories indefinitely without creating a different problem. Chapter 5, the paradox of synaptic shrinking. Here's something that sounds completely backwards until you understand it. One of the most important things your brain does during sleep is weaken connections between neurons. Wait, doesn't learning mean making connections stronger? Isn't that the whole point? Yes, during the day. While you're awake and learning, synapses, the connections between neurons, get stronger. Every new thing you learn, every skill you practice, strengthens certain neural pathways. But this creates a saturation problem. If synapses just kept getting stronger indefinitely, they'd eventually max out. The system would become overwhelmed. It would be like trying to highlight every word in a textbook. When everything is emphasized, nothing stands out. So during sleep, your brain runs a process called synaptic downscaling. It essentially turns down the volume on all those connections that got strengthened during the day. Not all connections get weakened equally, though. The ones that got the most reinforcement, the most important memories, the most practiced skills, stay relatively strong. The weaker, less significant connections fade more. The result? Better signal-to-noise ratio. The important stuff stands out more clearly because the background noise has been reduced. This is why you sometimes understand something better after sleeping on it. Your brain hasn't just preserved the information, it's refined it. Join our YouTube membership and get exclusive perks like early access to scripts, input on future topics about productivity, and connect with a like-minded community that gets it. Click join below and let's build your easier, more intentional life together. Chapter 6, the two-shift system. Now you understand why sleep matters for memory, but there's another layer here. Your brain handles different types of memories in different sleep stages. This is the two-shift system. During slow wave sleep, that deep dreamless stage, your brain primarily processes declarative memories. These are facts, events, dates, things you can consciously recall and describe. The capital of France, what you had for breakfast, the content of a lecture you attended. During REM sleep, the dreaming stage, your brain shifts to procedural memories. These are skills, motor patterns, how-to knowledge, how to ride a bike, how to play a chord on guitar, the muscle memory for a new exercise. The two stages work in sequence throughout the night. You cycle through them multiple times, and each cycle builds on the previous one. Here's what makes this matter. You need both. NREM sleep stabilizes the memories, locking them into place. REM sleep then processes them differently, reducing interference between similar memories, integrating new information with old. If you cut your sleep short, you're most likely cutting into REM. That stage dominates the later hours of sleep. So you might save the facts from yesterday's meeting, but lose the progress on the skill you were practicing. This two-stage partnership is essential, and it explains why fragmented sleep hurts even when the total hours seem okay. Skip either one and you lose half the benefit. Chapter 7. When the system breaks down. So far, we've talked about what optimal sleep does for you. Now, let's look at what happens when the system breaks down. Sleep deprivation doesn't just make you feel tired. It disrupts specific mechanisms in your brain at the molecular level. Your hippocampus relies on something called long-term potentiation to form memories. When you're sleep-deprived, this process gets disrupted. The receptors that facilitate memory formation, NMDA receptors, start malfunctioning. The chemical signals that should create lasting changes in your neurons get scrambled. The result? You can experience something, pay attention to it, feel like you're learning it, but it doesn't stick. Your brain loses the ability to convert short-term experiences into long-term memories. But it gets worse. There's a chemical called adenosine that builds up in your brain the longer you stay awake. It's essentially a fatigue signal, telling your brain it needs rest. Caffeine works by blocking adenosine receptors, which is why coffee makes you feel alert. When you're chronically sleep-deprived, adenosine accumulates faster than your brain can clear it. The energy balance in your neural systems gets thrown off. And here's the truly alarming part. Your neurons start having what researchers call off periods while you're still technically awake. Brief moments where they go silent, mimicking sleep patterns. Microsleeps happening in specific brain regions, even though you think you're fully conscious. You're awake, but parts of your brain are asleep. Chapter 8. The Chronotype Advantage. Let's shift to something you can actually control, when you sleep. You've probably noticed that some people naturally wake up at 6 a.m. feeling great, while others can barely function before noon. This isn't laziness or discipline. It's biology. Your chronotype, whether you're a morning person or an evening person, is largely determined by your genetics. It's baked into your circadian rhythm, the internal clock that regulates nearly every biological process in your body. And here's what the research shows. Night owls aren't broken morning people who just need to try harder. When scientists compared cognitive performance between chronotypes, they found something interesting. Night owls actually outperformed morning larks on tests of complex reasoning. Evening types showed advantages in tasks requiring creative problem solving and cognitive flexibility. Society is built around the morning person's schedule. Work starts early, schools start early. The early bird gets the worm mentality is woven into our culture. But if you're fighting your natural chronotype, you're fighting biology, and biology usually wins. The research suggests that aligning your sleep schedule with your chronotype, rather than forcing yourself into a schedule that contradicts your internal clock, produces sharper thinking and better cognitive performance. This doesn't mean night owls should sleep at random times. Consistency still matters, but the time window you choose might matter more than you thought. Chapter 9, quality over quantity. There's one variable in sleep research that shows up again and again as more important than most people realize. It's not how long you sleep, it's how well you sleep. Sleep quality, measured through metrics like how quickly you fall asleep, how often you wake up, how much time you spend in deep sleep, predicts cognitive performance better than total sleep duration. Think about what this means. 6 hours of deep, uninterrupted sleep may serve your brain better than 8 hours of fragmented, restless sleep. Researchers use something called the Pittsburgh Sleep Quality Index to measure this, and the results are consistent. People with higher quality scores perform better on tests of attention, memory, and executive function, independent of how many hours they logged. This also explains a puzzling finding. When people estimate their own sleep duration, they're often wrong by about an hour. Self-reports don't match what EEG recordings actually show. You might think you slept 8 hours, but if you spent a significant portion of that time in light sleep or brief awakenings, you don't remember. Your brain didn't get 8 hours of useful sleep. For students especially, this matters. Academic success correlates more strongly with sleep quality than sleep quantity. Studying an extra hour versus going to bed and sleeping well isn't an even trade. The quality of your sleep is a variable you can improve. Sleep disturbances, inconsistent schedules, environmental factors. These are often modifiable. Duration is just one number. Quality is where the real optimization happens. Chapter 10, your brain's nightly reconstruction project. Now let's talk about something that should genuinely amaze you, Your brain's physical structure changes based on how you sleep. This isn't metaphor. This isn't wellness exaggeration. Brain imaging studies have measured it directly. In the UK Biobank study, researchers found that sleep duration predicted the volume of gray matter in 46 distinct brain regions. Not one or two areas, 46. Your orbitofrontal cortex, involved in decision-making. Your precentral gyrus, which controls voluntary movement. Your amygdala, which processes emotions. Your hippocampus, critical for memory. Your cerebellum, which coordinates movement and cognition. All of these regions showed volume differences based on sleep habits. The relationship follows that same pattern we discussed earlier, optimal around 7 to 8 hours, with decline on either side. People sleeping in the sweet spot had measurably larger volumes in regions associated with executive function, memory, and emotional regulation. And here's what really stands out. Some of this damage appears reversible. The research suggests that improving your sleep habits can partially rebuild lost volume. Your brain isn't just passively decaying, it's actively responding to how you treat it. Give it the right conditions, and it can recover. Sleep is modifiable, and it might be more powerful than age in determining your cognitive trajectory. Chapter 11, The Complete Picture. Let's pull this all together. Optimal sleep isn't about hitting one magic number. It's about getting four variables right and understanding how they interact. First, duration. 7 hours is the cognitive peak for most people, with a healthy range between 6 and 8. Less than that, and you're not giving your brain enough time to complete its cycles. More than that, and you're potentially causing the same harm as deprivation. Second, quality. Deep, uninterrupted sleep matters more than hours logged. How you sleep determines whether those hours actually count. Frequent awakenings, light sleep phases, disrupted cycles. These all subtract from what your brain actually receives. Third, timing. Aligning your sleep schedule with your natural chronotype gives you a cognitive edge. Fighting your biology creates stress and reduces sleep quality. Work with your internal clock, not against it. Fourth, stage protection. Your brain needs both slow-wave sleep and REM sleep to complete memory consolidation. Cutting sleep short typically cuts into REM. Alcohol and certain medications can suppress specific stages, protecting the full architecture of sleep matters. These four factors don't just add up, they multiply. Great timing with poor quality still fails. Good duration with wrong timing still underperforms. The system works best when all components are addressed together. Chapter 12, Your Hidden Advantage Activated. You now understand something about sleep that most people will never grasp. Not because it's secret information, it's published in scientific journals anyone can access, but because most people never look beyond the 8 hours rule. They never learn about the U-curve, the synaptic downscaling, the two-stage memory system, the chronotype advantages. You have an edge now. Every night is an opportunity to optimize your most valuable asset, your brain, the organ that determines your ability to think, remember, create, and perform. Here's what you can do with this knowledge. Target 7 hours as your starting point, not 8. Track your sleep quality, not just your hours. Pay attention to how you feel cognitively after different sleep patterns. Notice your natural chronotype and stop fighting it. Protect your sleep architecture. That means consistent schedules, avoiding substances that disrupt sleep stages, creating conditions for uninterrupted rest. Remember that this is modifiable. Unlike your genetics, unlike your age, sleep is something you can change starting tonight. The research shows it might be the single most powerful lever you have for cognitive performance. You've been sleeping your whole life. Now you know what's actually happening during those hours, why it matters, and how to get the most from them. Sleep isn't downtime. It's upgrade time. And now you know how to use it. And hey, if you like this video, don't forget to subscribe and hit that like button. Also, let me know your thoughts on what I just shared. Oh, and there's more. I've just started a Patreon to help support these videos and connect with you more directly. Check out the link in the description if you'd like to join.